'n wonderlike voorreg om weer vanaand met u te kan die woord van die Here te kan deel en ons gaan dan aan met ons reeks getiteld Die Bybel, 'n bonatuurlike boek. En ons sien dan ook dat die Bybel hierdie aanspraak maak dat dit 'n God geïnspireerde boek is, dat die hele skrif deur God ingegee is en dat dit nie deur blote mense geskryf is as hulle gedagtes aangaande God nie, maar dat dit werklik God se woord is. En ons het gesien dat indien dit wel die woord van die lewende God is, ons dit bo alles moet koester, dit in diepte moet bestudeer, dit ten volle moet vertrou en dit ten volle moet gehoorsaam. En ons het ook gesê dat ons gaan aan die hand van 'n paar dinge gaan ons hierdie aanspraak wat die Bybel oor homself maak op die proef stel. En ons gaan vir u ongelooflike dinge wys wat ontdek is deur verskillende wetenskapsvelde wat vir ons wys dat die Bybel werklik waar die woord van die lewende God is. Ons is tans besig met ons tweede onderwerp, argeologie en die Bybel. Dis ons tweede sessie vanaand. En nou ons het in die vorige sessie het ons gesien dat daar talle en talle argeologiese bewyse gevind is vanaf die vloed dwarsdeur tot en met die rigters. So ons gaan dan aan vanaand met deel 2b, argeologie en die Bybel. Ek lees dit vir ons Psalm 85 vers 11 en die King James sê dit vir my so mooi en dit is vir my die mooiste vers in die Bybel wat vir my argeologie so mooi beskryf. Truth shall spring out of the earth. En waarlik, soos ons ook woensdag aand gesien het en soos jy ook vanaand sal sien, die waarheid van die Bybel spring letterlik op uit die aarde, soos wat die argeoloë Midde-Ooste opgrawe en die lande en die dele wat in die Bybel beskryf word, dan kom hierdie waarheid so mooi na vore en dan sien ons dat die Bybel werklik histories korrek is. Die vraag is natuurlik, waarmee ons vanavond wil begin, is daar enige argeologiese bewyse gevind wat die verhale van Dawid, Salomo en die rest van die koningsgeskiedenis, soos dit in die Bybel opgeteken is, staaf? Want daar is talle en talle kritici wat sê, Dawid en Salomo het nie regtig bestaan nie, en as hulle regtig bestaan en dan was dit maar 'n klein tribal kingdom soos hulle in Engels sal sê, en ons gaan vanaand vir u wys dat dit nie so is nie, dat die Bybel werklik waar die woord van die Here is en dat dit histories akkuraat is. Ons gaan kyk spesifiek nou vir die volgende paar skyfies na argeologiese bewyse wat in die stad van Dawid gevind is. Baie van u sal van dit herken wat al in Israel was. Ek gaan baie vinnig deur van dit hardloop. Ons gaan hier en daar 'n videoklip vir u wys en ek wil u aanmoedig om tog Dr. Don Patton se video Stones of Israel, kan dit op YouTube vind, waar hy al hierdie dinge in detail behandel. Ek gaan vanaand net daardeur hardloop terwyl hulle van tyd. In die eerste plek gaan ek vir u 'n videoklip wys van 'n argiefkamer wat ontdek is binne in die paleis van koning Dawid wat hulle opgegrawe het en waar hulle interessante dinge ontdek het.
You have what's referred to as the archive building for good reason. Important papers were kept here. Well, the papers were burned. They're not available to us. But the papers were sealed with a clay seal stamped by a signet ring or by a stamp of the official that was sending this important document. And this is where a number of them were stored because you find a lot of the seals. And when it's burned, actually the fire fires the clay and helps preserve it. 51 of these stamps, referred to as bully, have been found from this archive building that dates to the time of the end of the First Temple period, right at the time when the Babylonians came in and burned it. As we pointed out, these seals are often used to date things, and you see the thing that did the impressing on the left-hand side and the stamped clay that's been fired on the right-hand side. 51 of these were found, and as they began to look and read what they said, it was astounding. Here's one from Azariah, the son of Hilkiah, that's mentioned in 1 Chronicles 9. This was a member of the family of high priest who officiated the end of the First Temple period. Then we read of Jeremiah, the son of Shaphan. He's one of the scribes, a high official in the court of Jehoiakim, who was the king at the time that the Babylonians came marching in, reigned at the end of the First Temple period. Then Baruch, mentioned in the same verse, if you're familiar with Jeremiah, this was his scribe. He's mentioned some 26 times by Jeremiah, and we have two of Baruch's seals. Actually, one of them has his thumbprint in the back of it. This rather liberal, I'd say semi-liberal, archaeology book published in 98, Archaeology in the Old Testament, says this lump of clay used to close a papyrus document was sealed by none other than Baruch, the son of Neriah, specifying here Jeremiah 36 and 4. Then the king's son, who gave the orders to seize Jeremiah, to throw him into the pit, Gerahmeel, his seal. I mean, these were the kinds of people that would have documents with their stamp on them, and that's what we find in this archive building. The king's son is there. Actually, of the 51 bulli that were found, they attest to 26 mentioned in the Bible. 26 out of the 51 you have reference to. And of course, the Bible would be describing the officials of the court. And wow, how do you get greater, more obvious confirmation that the Bible knows what it's talking about when it describes these people?
Amen. Ja, hoe wil hulle nou beter bewys kry dat die Bybel van die koningsgeskiedenis en selfs in die profete, jy moet onthou dat die profete het geleef in die koningsgeskiedenis. Hulle het opgetree tydens die konings se regeringskap en later ook soos wat hulle deur die Assiriërs en later die Babiloniërs oorwin is. Wat ook in die stad van Dawid ontdek is, is die Gionfontein. Interessant dat baie beweer dat dit, veral as ou kyk na Bob Cornhook se boek, dat dit dalk baie naby is aan waar die eintlike tempel geleë behoort te wees. En ons lees van hierdie fontein in 1 Konings 1 vers 33. Hierdie fontein is net so ontdek soos wat die Bybel dit beskryf. Ook hoe dat, was dit Hiskia of Jehiskia wat later die watervoer herlei het na die weste kant. Hulle het daardie herleiding ook gevind, presies soos wat die Bybel dit beskryf. Ook die waterkanale, soos beskryf in 2 Samuel 5 vers 8. Jy sal onthou dat een van Dawid se manne het vir hom deur die watervoer opgeklim, een van hierdie waterkanale om die stad in te neem, en hy ingegaan deur die nag en hy het vir die hek oopgemaak en Dawid en sy manne het ingekom en dis waar hulle Jerusalem verower het. Hulle het hierdie talle van hierdie waterkanale ontdek wat dan natuurlik ook gevoed word deur hierdie Gionfontein. Meer as dit het hulle, lees ons in 1 Konings 1 vers 33, waar Dawid op sy sterfbed lê en hy vir die profeet sê dat hulle moet sy seun Salomo neem na die juist na die fontein Gion en hulle moet hom daar kroon as koning van Israel wat dan nou Dawid opvolg. En hulle het hierdie kamer ontdek waar, presies soos wat die Bybel dit beskryf het, waar Salomo gekroon is. Jehiskia se tonnel, baie van u wat al in Israel was, ongelukkig die 4 keer wat ek daar was, het ons dit nie een keer besoek nie, maar baie van u wat saam was Israel toe was, het al saam met Pastor Dries hulle deur hierdie tonnel geloop, en daar is baie wonderlike dinge ook rondom dit ontdek, en dit word vir ons opgeteken in 2 Kronieke 32 vers 30. Ook die bad van Siloam, waar hierdie tonnel dan nou uitloop, is ook net so ontdek soos wat die Bybel dit beskryf het, en ons lees selfs in die profete van hierdie bad, naamlik in Jesaja 8 vers 6, is maar een verwysing, so die bad van Siloam is ook in die stad van Dawid ontdek, presies soos wat die Bybel dit vir ons beskryf. Ook die toring van Siloam, nou in die Ou Testament is daar nie regtig verwysing na hierdie toring nie, maar ek plaas dit hierin, want dit was deel van die stad van Dawid. En dan natuurlik Lukas 13 praat Jesus spesifiek en dan vertel hy vir sy disippels van hoe dat hierdie toring mos op 'n paar mense geval het wat toe gedood is. Hy terug daarna verwys en so dis sommer 'n Nuwe Testamenties een wat ek ook vir u hier inrol, maar hy pas my mooi in want dis in die stad van Dawid net so gevind, althans nie die toring wat staan nie, maar dit wat oorgebly het nadat hy geval het op daardie mense. En tot vandag toe. Ook die muur van Jehiskia, wat in 2 Kronieke 32 vers 2 tot 5 vir ons beskryf word, hoe dat hy die muur versterk het, het hulle ontdek net so. En nou ook die muur van Nehemia, wat 'n versterkte muur was, dit is nadat Israel teruggekeer het van Babylon af, het Esra en Nehemia, sal jy onthou, het hulle die tempel en die mure van Jerusalem herbou, en Nehemia se muur is net so ontdek, presies soos wat die Bybel dit beskryf het, en as jy na daardie prentjie kyk, hy is bietjie klein op die skerm, op die rekenaar en op die TV sal hy groter verskyn, sal jy sien dat hierdie muur spesifiek ook versterk, soos wat hulle dit in daardie tyd deur baie koninkryke gedoen het, en dit is net so ontdek. Dawid en Salomo se grafte is ook ontdek. Ons lees van Dawid waar hy gesterf het in 1 Konings 2 vers 10 en waar Salomo sterf in 1 Konings 11 vers 43 en hoe dat hulle begrawe is in die stad van Dawid. Hulle grafte is net so ontdek en hulle het die kiste daar verwyder. Die hartseer is dat koningin Helena, wat die ma was van Constantijn, Sy het die hele Israel bebou met 'n klomp monumente en sy het dinge uitgewys wat baie plekke wat glad nie eers argeologiese waarde eintlik het. En die hartseer was, sy het daar waar hierdie grafte ontdek is, 'n steen, wat is 'n quarry nou in Afrikaans gehad, wat sy is ja, steengroef gehad waar sy die stene onthul het om haar kathedrale en dinge mee te bou en kerke daar in Israel. En so hulle het eintlik daai hele area daar baie verniel deur hierdie klippe daar te onthul, en aan die einde van die dag het hulle toe op hierdie grafte afgekom. Verder is ook Dawid se paleis onthul, en nou moet jy onthou, baie van die skeptici het gesê dat Dawid was nie 'n baie ryk koning nie, ook nie Salomo nie. Hoor net bietjie hoe groot was hierdie man se paleis wat vir hom gebou is.
King David's palace is found. The thing that Kenyon said is not there, don't look, just forget it. An Israeli archaeologist says he's uncovered in East Jerusalem what may be the fabled palace of the biblical King David. King Tyre sent messengers to David with cedar trees, carpenters, stonemasons. They built a house for David. So King Tyre is the capital of Phoenicia, and he's building a house for David. Of course, he married his daughter. And so we would look for a Phoenician-style palace in the middle of Jerusalem, which would be rather easy to identify, and that's exactly what Alot Mazar has found. She's with Hebrew University. It was her grandfather who found those steps on the southern part of the Temple Mount that there beside the Gate Beautiful. Where is this monumental building? Well, here is a monumental building that she found. It is huge. This is what was uncovered, actually, just this picture was able to be taken this year, and that's just a part of it. It continues on the other side of the street. It's at least six stories high. And from this picture on the other side of the street where we were working this past summer, you can see the levels as it goes down and down and down. It is huge. Monumental is almost a trivial word by comparison, and it was a joy to be able to work there and to be able to help excavate this. You can get a little bit of idea of the work that's going on. Looking at the pottery, we found that this was clearly identified. Some of it pictured here in place as it was being uncovered is from the 10th century, which is definitely identifying it as the time of David. The location is seen just below the Temple Mount, as indicated here by this square. Notice her description of how she found it. And this is from the New York Times. Archaeology is technical, but you dig with a mind open to historical sources, and anything can help. I work with the Bible in one hand, the tools of excavation in the other, and try to consider everything. One of the main clues in finding David's palace, says Mazar, was surprisingly from the Bible itself. David, 2 Samuel 5:17, heard about it, went down from his palace to the citadel. He knew where the citadel was. The palace has to be up above. And so she published in one of the technical journals, this is where the Bible says it ought to be. I need to raise some money. I want to go dig. This is a test of what the Bible says before anything was found. And that's where she dug, and she found it, just exactly as she had published that she should find it. Notice the way this is analyzed, I think, scientifically, in one of the commentaries there from Jerusalem. We have a biblical text describing in detail the creation of a Phoenician-style palace by David high up on a particular mountain. You've got a particular mountain, you've got a Phoenician-style palace, we've got the text describing it, around the end of the 11th, beginning of the 10th century, before the current era. Then we have a grand structure, the Phoenician style, dating from the same time on the summit of that very mountain, located with the assistance of the text and previous archaeological discoveries. This was not stumbled upon, moreover, but carefully hypothesized, and the current dig was proposed as a test. The likelihood of this happening by chance is extremely small. And I think you just have to say amen. This is the way science should proceed. It did. And it's confirmed. Sorry, liberals, that's just the way it is.
Yeah. Sorry liberals, that's just the way it is. Is dit nie waar nie? Is dit nie hoe ons eintlik ons teologie en ons argeologie moet bedryf nie? As ons die Bybel lees, dit is so mooi, sy het na die Bybel gekyk en sy het gaan geld aan mekaar maak voor daar enigiets gevind is en gesê, maar die Bybel sê dit moet daar wees en sy het 'n 6 verdieping hoë paleis ontdek. Kan nie dink. Dawid, 'n arm koning. Ja. Salomo se versterkte poorte is ook ontdek presies op die 3 plekke waar die Bybel beskryf hoe dit moet wees vir ons in 1 Konings 9 vers 15.
The fortified gates of Solomon have been known for half dozen years, but they're interesting confirmation of what we read in 1 Kings chapter 9. This is the account of the forced labor which King Solomon levied to build the house of the Lord, his own house, the Milo, this is at Jerusalem, and then also he built at Hazor and Megiddo and Gezer. Well, of course, Solomon is this fictitious creature like Zeus that the real scholars don't believe in. But what did he do at Hazor and Megiddo and Gezer? Well, you go there and you find these strange-looking gates that guard the city. Very difficult to break through these gates into the city with this kind of fortification. And the places where you find these gates are at Hazor and Megiddo and Gezer. And the pottery that we find associated with the gates is from the time of Solomon. Isn't that a surprise? I think that's exactly what the text describes. That's where Solomon built.
Amen. Wanneer mense na hierdie bewyse kyk in verband met Dawid en Salomo, dan kan mense nie anders as om tot die volgende gevolgtrekking te kom nie. En so sê Jane Cahill West, sy was 'n senior personeellid by hierdie opgrawing van koning Dawid se stad. En sy sê die volgende: the most frequent voiced argument by those who challenge the historical existence of the United Monarchy is a supposed lack of archaeological evidence. In most cases, these arguments are either grossly misleading, illogical, disingenuous, or all three. Kan ons dit maar opsom en sê, die wat teen dit stry, lieg. Dis maar eintlik wat sy vir ons sê. En sy was deel van die opgrawingsspan wat die stad van Dawid opgegrawe het. Ander buitebybelse bronne, kom ons kyk bietjie na die res van die koningsgeskiedenis. Ons lees in 1 Konings 14 vers 25 tot 26 van die veldtog teen Israel deur Farao Sisak. En interessant dat daar op die tempel van Amun se muur in Thebes, Egipte, is hierdie aanval baie in groot detail beskryf en stem dit geweldig ooreen. Hierdie Egiptiese hieroglife wat gevind is met die Bybelse beskrywing van hierdie veldtog van hierdie Farao teen Israel. Die opstand van Moab teen Israel, waarvan ons lees in 2 Konings 1 en in 2 Konings 3, is ook opgeteken op die Mesa-inskripsie, wat deur Moab se koning aangeteken is, wat ooreenstem met die Bybelse verhaal wat hierdie opstand van Moab teen Israel vir ons beskryf. Die val van Samaria en ook Asdod, soos ons daarvan lees in 2 Konings 17, 2 Konings 18 en Jesaja 20, is ook opgeteken teen Salmaneser se paleismuur. Hy was die koning wat Israel binnengeval het van die Assiriërs en dit is net so opgeteken en dit stem geweldig ooreen met die bewyse wat ons ook natuurlik dan nou in die Bybel vind. Die veldtog van koning Sanherib teen Juda, waarvan ons lees in 2 Konings 18, is ook aangeteken op die Tylerprisma. Die belering van Lagus deur Sanherib, soos aangeteken in 2 Konings 18, is ook aangeteken op die Lagus reliefs. Ook sit teen 'n muur. En jy kan ook daaroor gaan oplees, dis geweldig interessante ontdekkings wat hulle gemaak het, buite Bybelse bronne, wat vir ons keer op keer op keer, en ek wys maar vir die punt van die ijsberg, wat vir ons wys dat die Bybelse rekord geskiedkundig akkuraat is. Die val van Ninive, so 'n paar weke terug het pastoor Dries met ons gepraat oor Jona, en hoe dat hy die stad gewaarsku het, hulle het tot bekering gekom, God het die oordeel uitgestel, maar hulle het weer verval in hulle ou weë en Ninive se val is voorspel deur profete soos Naam en Sefanja, onder andere in Sefanja 2. En hierdie val van Ninive is ook in groot detail dan beskryf op die kliptafel van Nabo Pelasar, wat ook die Bybelse beskrywing daarvan sterk staaf. Die val van Jerusalem onder Nebukadneser, die koning van Babylon, word vir ons beskryf in 2 Konings 24 en dit is ook opgeteken in die Babyloniese kronieke. Daar is 'n steen, een van die stene van die Babyloniese kronieke wat Nebukadneser self laat skryf het, hoe dat hy Jerusalem verower het, wat ook ooreenstem met dit wat die Bybel vir ons beskryf. Die val van Babylon onder die Meders en die Perse, wat vir ons beskryf word in Daniël hoofstuk 5 vers 30 tot 31, as ook die terugkeer van die Jode. Wat onthou toe koning Kores van die Meders en die Perse Babylon verower het, het Daniël vir hom gewys wat die profete hom by die naam genoem het. Ek dink is die profet Jesaja gewees en hy het toe aggegee daarop en hy het die Israeliete laat terugkeer na hulle land. En dit is vir ons opgeteken in Esra 1 en Esra 6 en dit is ook opgeteken op die Kores silinder, hierdie opdrag wat uitgevaardig is dat hulle kan terugkeer na hulle land en dat hulle die Jerusalem, die mure en die tempel kan herbou, is alles vir ons ook daarin opgeteken. Hierdie was slegs 'n paar van die talle en talle bewyse wat opgelewer is deur argeoloë. Hierdie bevindinge bewys dat die Ou Testament geskiedkundig akkuraat is. Argeologie in die Bybel, professor Miller Burrows, hy was professor van argeologie by Yale Universiteit, tot sy dood, hy het die volgende gesê: "On the whole, archaeological work has unquestionably strengthened confidence in the reliability of the scriptural record. More than one archaeologist has found his respect for the Bible increased by the experience of excavation in Palestine. Archaeology has in many cases refuted the views of modern critics." Ons kom by die Nuwe Testament. En ek wil daar 'n bietjie langer by van hierdie dinge stil staan. In die eerste plek, die verhaal van Jesus is vir ons opgeteken in die vier evangelies, Matteus, Markus, Lukas en Johannes, en die verhaal van die eerste kerk is opgeteken in die boek Handelinge en dan natuurlik al die sendbriewe wat uitgestuur is. Meeste van hulle het ook is geskryf tydens die geskiedenis wat vir ons opgeteken is in die boek Handelinge. Kom ons kyk na 'n paar interessante ontdekkings wat dateer uit die Nuwe Testament tydperk. Ek wil eerstens bietjie stil staan by 'n paar prominente figure uit Jesus se tyd. Van hulle is ook beweer deur skeptici dat hulle maar fiktiewe karakters was en mense wat uitgedink is deur die Bybelskrywers. Kom ons kyk na van hulle. Lukas 3 vers 1 tot 2 gee vir ons 'n lys. En in die 15de jaar, hoor die detail, van die regering van keiser Tiberius, toe Pontius Pilatus goewerneur was van Judea en Herodes viervors van Galilea en Filippus sy broer viervors van Iturea en in die land Tragonitis en Lysanias viervors van Abilene, tydens die hoëpriesterskap van Annas en Caiaphas het die woord van God gekom tot Johannes die seun van Sagaria in die woestyn. Hier word vir ons 'n paar prominente figure genoem wat in Jesus se lewe 'n rol gespeel het. Daar is talle bewyse gevind vir keiser Tiberias en vir van hierdie ander manne waar ek nie vanaand spesifiek gaan praat nie. Ek wil fokus op Pontius Pilatus, Herodes en die hoëpriester Caiaphas, want dis mense wat prominente rolle veral in die lewe van Jesus en rondom sy kruisiging gespeel het. In eerste plek Pilatus. Ons lees van hom in Matteus 27 vers 24 waar hy Jesus voor die skare bring. En hy vir hulle sê, hy vind geen skuld in Jesus nie, en hy was sy hande in onskuld. Is maar een van die verwysings na hom. En skeptici meen dat Pilatus was 'n fiktiewe karakter. Tot onlangs. Want daar's talle bewyse gevind dat Pilatus werklik bestaan het en die pos beklee het wat die Bybel wel aan hom toeskryf. Onder andere is daar geskrifte van Flavius Josephus wat in redelik detail vir ons beskryf wie Pilatus was. Ook Philo van Alexandrië was ook 'n geskiedskrywer uit daardie tyd en dan natuurlik ook die Romeine se eie geskiedskrywer Cornelius Tacitus het ook redelik baie oor hierdie man te sê gehad. Ek kan ongelukkig nie vir al die verwysings wys nie, ons gaan uit tyd uit hardloop, maar jy kan gerus bietjie daar gaan oplees. Maar meer as dit, 'n argeologiese opgrawing in Caesarea is daar hierdie steen ontdek in 1961 deur Antonio Frova en dit bevat die volgende inskripsie. Dis 'n Latynse inskripsie en as jy dit vertaal, dan staan daar Tiberius Pontius Pilatus, goewerneur van Judea. En dit dateer uit die eerste eeu, so dit is definitief 'n direkte argeologiese bewys dat Pilatus 'n werklike goewerneur was in die tyd van Jesus en daar geregeer het. Dan volgende sien ons koning Herodes. Nou daar was eintlik drie van hulle, sy twee seuns, sy seun na hom is ook Herodes genoem en sy die een daarna is ook Herodes genoem. Hierdie was egter Herodes die grootte. Hy was die een wat geregeer het toe Jesus gebore is, wat al die babetjies laat uitmoor het in Bethlehem en nou eintlik 'n verskriklike man gewees en daar is van sy muntstukke gevind. Vir baie jare het hulle ook gemeen dat hy was 'n fiktiewe karakter. Van die muntstukke met sy inskripsie op is gevind. Hy was ook natuurlik 'n geweldige liefhebber van pragtige geboue en hy het geweldig geboue opgerig in hele Israel, onder andere Masada waar ons ook al was. Baie van u was saam met ons al daar en waar hy 'n groot paleis gebou het op hierdie berg en ons talle opgrawings ook van hom daar gemaak. Ook Herodium wat eintlik 'n mensgemaakte berg is. Hierdie man was so lief vir bou dat hy 'n hele berg vir hom laat bou het en 'n groot kasteel daarop gebou het, 'n fortress in Engels, en dis ook waar hulle natuurlik sy graf gevind het en ook sy kus. En die aard van die saak, omdat hy so verskriklike wrede mens was, hy het van sy eie kinders laat doodmaak en self doodgemaak en allerlei verskriklike goed gedoen en die Jode geweldig onderdruk, het hulle aanvanklik toe hulle sy kus ontdek het, het van die Jode uit daai tyd het hulle daai graf van hom vernietig. En maar die argeoloë het hierdie kus van hom aan, het hulle die stukke bymekaar gemaak en dit aan mekaar gesit en die inskripsies is daarby gevind. Hier is werklik Herodes se kus. Hulle het ook sy graf gevind. Verder, die hoëpriester Kajafas in 1990 is die ossuarium. Dis maar 'n beenkus waar hulle doodsbeendere bære, want hoe die Jode mense begrawe het, is hulle het jou vir 'n jaar lank in 'n graf gesit en dan het hulle gewag tot die meeste van die vleis en die dinge nou al weg is, dan het hulle na 'n jaar teruggekom en die beendere gevat en dit in 'n so 'n ossuarium geplaas en dit dan mooi in 'n graf gesit. En so is die kus van Kajafas ontdek, saam met van sy ander familielede se kuste, met die inskripsies op. Kajafas, die hoëpriester, sy kus is ontdek. Nou, ander figure uit Jesus se tyd. Baie mense kan nou redeneer en sê, ja, mens kan nou 'n bietjie navorsing doen en 'n storie gaan skryf, en navorsing doen oor 'n antieke era, en jy kan gaan kyk, wie was die sterk politieke leiers, en wie was die sterk geestelike leiers, en wie is die ouens wat opgetree het, en wat groot naam gemaak het, en dan kan 'n mens nou enige storie rondom dit skryf, en 'n paar bekende plekke uit daardie tyd noem, en 'n storie uitdink. En ek sal dit toegee, dat dan, dis wat baie skeptici sê, dat hierdie bewyse van hierdie hoë figure is nie noodwendige bewys dat Jesus werklik geleef het nie. Maar my broeder en suster, wat as hulle iets ontdek van iemand wat eintlik geen sê in Israel gehad het nie? Iemand wat eintlik glad nie 'n hoë pos bekleed nie? Iemand wat eintlik niks meer as 'n slaaf was nie? Wat in detail in die Bybel beskryf word, wat as hulle iets van so 'n persoon ontdek? In Markus 15 vers 21 lees ons, en hulle het 'n sekere Simon van Sirene wat van die veld afgekom het, die vader van Alexander en Rufus gedwing om Jesus se kruis te dra. In eerste plek, die mense van Sirene kom uit Afrika, dit was swart mense. In die aard van die saak was Simon en sy familie swart mense wat die Joodse geloof aangeneem het, wat in Israel gaan woon het, en hulle het hierdie man gedwing om Jesus se kruis te dra. Meeste van die geskiedskrywers meen, wel, nie die geskiedskrywers nie, as jy net na die Bybel kyk, meeste Bybelkenners meen dat hy was eintlik niks meer as 'n gewone slaaf nie. Wat so opspraakwekkende ding het hy gedoen buiten wat in die Bybel opgeteken is? Maar in 1941 het Eleazar Sukenik, het geleef vanaf 1989 tot 1953, het hy 'n graf ontdek van 'n Sireniese familie, 'n hele familie wat uit Sirene kom. En dis bewys deur die aardewerke wat daarin gevind is en al die aardewerke wat in daardie graf gevind is dateer uit voor 70 na Christus. En hulle het ook 'n ossuarium ontdek in die Kidron-vallei met die duidelike inskripsie Alexander die seun van Simon in 'n Sireniese graf. En die Bybel maak 'n paar keer melding van Alexander die seun van Simon van Sirene. Wat vir ons 'n baie, baie spesifieke bewys is, dat die Bybel se skrywers, veral die skrywers van die evangelies, gefokus het om dinge histories in detail neer te skryf. Hulle wou spesifiek 'n biografie van Jesus neerskryf in die fynste detail. En hier is 'n kosbare bewys, dat die verhaal van Jesus werklik neergepen is, soos wat ons dit dan, dat dit werklik gebeur het, soos wat dit vir ons neergepen is. Nog 'n hier sien nou prominente figure uit Jesus se tyd, is eintlik ander figure uit Jesus se tyd. Nog een wat 'n rol gespeel het in Jesus se lewe, maar nie noodwendig 'n groot rol in die Romeinse wêreld nie, is Jakobus, die halfbroer van Jesus. Ons lees in Matteus 13 vers 55, waar Jesus in Nasaret is, en dan vra die Jode wat daar met hom praat, is hy nie die seun van die timmerman nie? Is die naam van sy moeder nie Maria en die van sy broers Jakobus en Joses en Simon en Judas nie? En dan sal jy onthou dat sy eie broers het aanvanklik nie in hom geglo nie. Johannes 7 vers 5 sê, want ook sy broers het nie in hom geglo nie. Maar dan lees ons dat Jesus na sy opstanding 'n punt daarvan gemaak het om aan Jakobus, sy halfboetie, te verskyn. 1 Korinte 15 vers 7 sê, daarna het hy verskyn aan Jakobus, daarna aan al die apostels. En Jakobus het so kragdadige bekering beleef dat hy 'n leier geword het in die eerste kerk. In Galasiërs 2 vers 9 lees ons dat Jakobus, Sefas en Johannes was as pilare geag. Meer as dit, in Handelinge 15 sien ons dat by die eerste synode sitting, Petrus was nie die eerste kerkleier nie, my broeder en suster, Jakobus was, die halfbroer van Jesus. Petrus was nooit die kerkleier nie. Hy was een van die pilare, maar Jakobus was die voorsitter van die synode sitting in Handelinge 15, waar hulle gepraat het oor baie dinge, en interessant dat toe almal stil bly, nadat almal geswyg het, nadat almal hulle stories op die, hulle punt op die tafel gesit het, staan Jakobus op en hy sê, broeders, luister na my, en hy gee die uitspraak, geïnspireerd deur die Heilige Gees, en daar kan ons duidelik sien dat hy was toe die leier van die eerste kerk. Maar in 2002, my broeder en suster, is 'n ossuarium gevind in 'n graf in die Kidron-vallei. Die duidelike inskripsie op die ossuarium lei, Jakobus, die seun van Josef, die broer van Jesus. En hierdie ossuarium dateer uit die eerste eeu voor Christus, en daar was vir oor die 7 jaar was daar hofsaake oor hierdie saak, en ek wil vir u net weer 'n video wys waar Dr. Dan Patton vir ons mooi die bewyse gee van hierdie kus, dat dit werklik autentiek is en werklik die kus van Jakobus, die broer van Jesus.
This is an ossuary, a bone box that pertains to the custom of the Jews in the first century, ended in 70 AD with the destruction of Jerusalem, began about the first part of that first century, and involved the burial, laying on a shelf in a tomb, and then coming back about a year later, opening the tomb, gathering the bones, then denuded of the flesh, and put into this bone box, made of limestone, typically carved, about 22 inches long on the average to accommodate the longest bone in the body, which would be the femur. They refer to it, this example, as evidence of Jesus written in stone. The inscription on this ossuary says, James, the brother of Jesus, the son of Joseph, was also a part of it. When it was first announced back in 2002, Biblical Archaeology Review described it as being of breathtaking significance. Herschel Shanks, who's the editor of that journal, says it's the most important find in the history of New Testament archaeology. Well, maybe. It certainly would be in that category. Looking carefully at the corner, you can almost see from this view, this etching. A closer view is the Aramaic, which says, James, son of Joseph, brother of Jesus. Almost all of the ossuaries have simply one name, better than 95% do. Very few have two names. Only two have been found that have three names, referring to the father as well as to a brother, and that was to a high priest. This would indicate it is of special significance, and the combination of James and Joseph and Jesus, while common names in that era, the combination makes it extremely unlikely that it would be anyone other than the one obviously indicated. Well, is this a real artifact? There was a great deal of controversy, but the Geological Society there in Israel looked at this to verify it and put out an official statement. Well, the looking at the patina, this coating that forms over thousands of years, this has to be authentic. And here we see Professor John McRae, who is author of the Archaeology in the New Testament, said six different pieces of patina, this coating that forms over years, of the stone looked at through the laboratory. It was verified by people who are not Christians that the date on this first century is the first century. There's no evidence of recent disturbances of the box. And so those who were Jews, who were not Christians, authenticated this initially. In fact, Eric Myers, who's professor of Judaic Studies, director of the graduate program of religion at Duke University, said, "I have no question that it is an ancient artifact from the first century." However, as the implications began to sink in and people began to realize just what this means, direct evidence of James, the brother of Jesus, there began to be a good deal of opposition. And the Dallas Morning News reported the action by the official archaeological body in Israel, saying that this was not real. They found evidence of fraud, we're told. That wasn't from scholars, it was from those who had no expertise in the area. And they came up with some 15 witnesses and brought charges against the one who was the one who possessed this. But the owner of the ossuary was charged with forgery and then endured a 7-year trial together with another friend of his who was also charged with forgery. The verdict was just handed down March 14th of this year, not guilty. And reported here in Biblical Archaeology Review, the forgery trial of the century has concluded in a Jerusalem courtroom. Defendants have been acquitted of all major charges. And then we find the conclusion reported of all places in the Wall Street Journal. The James Ossuary is what it seems, the earliest recorded reference to Jesus of Nazareth. That's rather amazing.
Amen. Ja, die duisternis probeer die lig oorweldig en hulle sal alles probeer, maar die lig sal seëvier en het is bewys dat hierdie 'n werklike artefak is uit die tyd van Jesus of net daarna. En so sien ons dan die sekere van die oudste bewyse dat Jesus werklik geleef het op hierdie aarde. Die boek Handelinge, kom ons kyk vinnig bietjie na die boek Handelinge. Ek wil eers vir jou 'n video wys, baie interessant. The Search for the Lost Shipwreck of Paul. Jy sal as jy Handelinge 27 lees, sal jy sien waar Paulus toen al gevange geneem is. Hy het homself beroep op die keizer en daarom moet hulle hom toe na Rome neem en op pad daarheen het hy skipbreek gelei en natuurlik baie min van die skip het oorgebly. Die Bybel sê self vir ons dat die skip is feitelik uit mekaar geslaan, maar hulle het 4 ankers uitgegooi voordat hulle op die strand afgestuur het en natuurlik sal daar gedeeltes van die ankers wees wat oorgebly het en kom ons kyk of hulle dit ontdek het.
The year was 65 AD. The Apostle Paul was a marked man, imprisoned by the Romans, accused of blasphemy by the Jews. Paul had already spent 2 years in prison and survived several attempts on his life. A Roman citizen by birth, Paul appealed his case to Caesar himself and so was sent to Rome under the watchful eye of a centurion named Julius, where his fate would be decided once and for all. They made it to Myra. And though the winter was closing in, the centurion found a large Alexandrian grain freighter bound for Rome and booked passage for his party. They sailed with difficulty to the Isle of Crete. Paul's advice was to winter there, but the centurion decided instead to continue toward Rome. It was a mistake that nearly cost him his life.
On the 14th night, we were still being driven across the Adriatic Sea, when about midnight, the sailors sensed that they were approaching land. They took soundings and found the water was 120 feet deep. A short time later, they took soundings again and found it was 90 feet deep. Fearing that we would be dashed against the rocks, they dropped 4 anchors from the stern and prayed for daylight. When daylight came, they did not recognize the land, but they saw a bay with a sandy beach where they decided to run the ship aground if they could. Cutting loose the anchors, they left them in the sea.
I just happened upon the search for Paul's shipwreck by accident. It was involving a shipwreck of my own over in Ethiopia. And I looked at the Bible and said, could I solve this like it was a crime? Could I take the evidence that exists on the pages of the Bible and go over and find the evidence that exists in archaeology and the topography and in the history of Malta and actually find these lost anchors that the Bible talks about? And so I came to Malta and I started my journey.
Maltese tradition holds that Paul's shipwreck occurred on that island right over there in what's now known as St. Paul's Bay on the northwestern side of the island. Thousands of tourists come here every year to visit the site, and a chapel was built nearby to commemorate the event. But there's only one problem. Very little about this area matches the biblical account. So Bob knew he had to find a different site if he was going to find the true location of Paul's shipwreck.
Cornuke believed the truth could be found by simply following the clues laid out in Scripture.
The Bible is the ultimate authority. The Bible is the source of truth. Jesus talking to the Sadducees in Mark 7:13 says, hey, your traditions will nullify the Word of God. In other words, if we start following man's traditions and not the Bible, we're going to run into problems. The reformers used to use the term, Latin term called afuantes, which means go to the source, to get the answers to all these mysteries of the Bible.
Bob surmised that the four anchors might hold the key to unraveling the mystery of where Paul's ship actually ran aground nearly 2,000 years ago.
People say, well, anchors would dissolve and they're made out of wood. They are made out of wood, but there's a lead stock, kind of like the cross that you see in a Navy insignia. That crossbar is solid lead and is very resilient in salt water and would last a long time, certainly 2,000, maybe 3, 4, 5,000 years. But these anchors would survive in salt water. When I read all the details in the Bible, I remember saying to myself, could these anchors possibly be found today?
The Search and Rescue Service in Malta has a great reputation for rescuing sailors lost in the Mediterranean.
We are using software here that can calculate drift of any search object. You define what is the search object.
And the Bible says that the sailors were worried about striking this part of Africa, the Syrtis.
For periods of 2 days at a time, we have drifted the object, taking consideration the kind of weather described in the Bible, and surprisingly, even to me, they ended up in Malta, exactly as the Bible says.
And his jaw dropped and he said, look, the ship landed on the coast of Malta on the 14th night about midnight, according to the computer, which is exactly what the Bible said, and it landed right in the southeast quadrant of Malta. That's where the drift would have taken it, which means it could not have gone to the traditional side.
If the ship made landfall somewhere on the southeast coast of Malta, as the computer projected, it would be a major breakthrough for Bob's search for the anchors. Cornuke began searching for a likely bay on the southeast coast of Malta that fit the biblical narrative.
What I did is I started my search by going out with these fishermen that knew the weather, knew the currents, knew the topography of the ocean. They took me out with them and they explained to me all the possible places based on what the Bible narrative says to where the shipwreck of Paul could have been.
The more Bob dug into the mystery surrounding the shipwreck, the more people he met who had a similar interest in finding the actual place where the Roman freighter ran aground. One of those people was James Mulholland.
You must have 120 feet and 90 feet of water. So the west coast is out of question. It's all over 200 feet, the west coast. So based on the east coast, it's a must. And we have five major bays. We've got the Meliha Bay, we've got Salina Bay, Baluta Bay, St. George's Bay, and we've got St. Thomas's Bay.
Narrowing down the most likely spot took looking for clues in the Book of Acts.
As the dawn broke, they did not recognize the land. Now, that's the most interesting thing. One says, we need a bay with a reef. There must be a reef. But Luke writes more than the reef. He says, our ship hit between two seas. It's a long, long tongue coming out. The two seas are meeting this land coming out. Now, it means two seas are meeting each other. The only place to find 120 feet to 90 feet, a reef, a place with two seas, not a harbor, and no identification, you start eliminating one by one, you finish up with one bay. And that is St. Thomas's Bay.
So really, the only candidate that makes sense, this is archaeology 101, that it should be the Moonshar Reef on St. Thomas Bay. Clearly, this is the place that it should be according to all the factors that the Bible gives.
Bob searched out some Maltese divers who would be able to tell him what the seafloor looked like around the Moonshar Reef. Cornuke explained his theory about St. Thomas Bay and his intention to search the seafloor for the anchors from the ancient shipwreck. But Ray's answer gave Bob the shock of his life.
When he said, "Hey, Bob, in the late 60s and early 70s, we dug up four anchors from the ocean bottom." And the divers told me that they had found anchors in the ocean bottom, exactly where the Bible said, where I thought that they should be. I was stunned. And then they turned the ship, the Bible says, and they came up and they hit an island called Malta. If you take that course in that direction, you land right at this point here, right at the southeast point of St. Thomas Bay. And interestingly enough, four anchors were found in the water here at the exact depth the Bible says.
Four anchors, all found in 90 feet of water, within a few meters of where Bob had surmised they would be. Could they be the lost anchors of Paul? Before he could answer that question, he had to see them for himself.
Of course, when I found out that they brought up the anchors, I said, "Where are they?" And I was stunned to find out that they had brought them up with lift bags and taken them ashore and put them in their back of their trunks of their cars, and they carted them off to their homes.
Ray introduced Bob to a whole group of divers who had helped recover the anchors from Moonshar Reef. One name in particular kept coming up, that of the diver who found the first anchor. His name was Tony McAuliffe Borg, and Bob knew Tony would be the key to tracking down where the four anchors had ended up. There was only one problem. Tony had been dead for almost 30 years.
I remember I met Tony at one of these athletic meetings. I was a teacher, he was a teacher. First we started snorkeling together, but he said, "We'll start fishing together so you don't get into problems." I was a feeble looking guy compared with him, he's a big man. They called us the underwater cowboys.
As fishermen, these divers spent lots of time underwater, scouring reefs for fish they could sell to local restaurants. And that's how Tony McAuliffe Borg made what may have been his most valuable find ever.
Tony told me, "Joe, I need your help because I found an anchor and we want to bring it up." I said, "Fair enough, Tony." So off we went. It wasn't a very nice day because I have dived so many times with Tony, but I must say that the time we brought up that anchor, it gave us so many problems. I always said to myself, there is something tied up with this thing. You say to yourself, "But what am I doing? But this could be, you know, something, a treasure. You know, it's not something that you normally find on the bottom. There must be some value here." But this time, it was tough, even to bring it out. We had lifting bags, we had these drums, oil drums, then you just take your DV out, put air into it. First, you're starting a rumble. Then it tears itself from the bottom, and it starts floating slowly up.
Before long, Tony spotted a second anchor, very close to where the first one had been found.
And the second one, the particular interest of the second one was that because it was broken, and obviously it was broken because there was some real brute force being put onto it. In full size, it was like something like this, and it was cut right where the center wood piece would fit, just off of that.
In those days, lead was a very valuable commodity, and since the second anchor had been broken in half, Tony decided to melt it down and use it to make dive weights for his shop.
Because it was broken, it didn't have that much real value, history-wise, so Tony took the decision to melt this thing down. Terrible mistake, obviously.
Over time, two additional anchors were brought up from the site. All were found on the outside of the Moonshar Reef
in about 90 feet of water. Tony and his friends continued diving and spearfishing the waters around Malta, never knowing what they might have found.
These anchors were found, interestingly enough, right off of this point here, and all of the physical descriptions given in the Bible, all of them, come together right here in a unique, very powerful way.
The anchors made their way to the various homes of the divers who found them, and they could have easily remained in obscurity forever. It took Bob several years to track down all four anchors.
This is it. It's the fourth anchor. We've been looking for this for 2 years.
But the story doesn't end there.
It was a crime to even bring up something from the ocean bottom. And once I told them that these anchors could actually be from Paul's shipwreck, it created a whole new set of problems.
By working closely with the Maritime Museum here in Valletta and with the Maltese government, Bob was able to secure amnesty for the divers, who then turned the anchors over to the museum.
And though the curators there acknowledged that the anchors were from the Roman era, so far they refused to recognize the potential importance of the find. The strength of Maltese tradition has proven almost impenetrable. But since Bob's book about the shipwreck theory was published several years ago, more of the residents of this Mediterranean isle are starting to come around. One of them is Douglas Gresham, a Maltese resident whose famous stepfather is known around the world as C.S. Lewis.
I'm fascinated by the whole idea that we now know, I think, where Paul came ashore. There's so much evidence. I used to get all excited about the fact that you can go to St. Paul's Bay and look out on St. Paul's Island. I think that's where he actually came ashore. So when somebody in New Zealand, funnily enough, a New Zealand broadcaster said, look, I've just come across a book you have to read, and sent me a copy of Bob Cornuke's book, The Lost Shipwreck of St. Paul, I thought I was going to be hearing all about how he came ashore on St. Paul's Island and so forth. Started to read this thing and became fascinated. So the more I got into it, the more I thought, this guy knows what he's doing. He presents the case for his theory of where Paul actually came ashore, not as some kind of wishy-washy, this would be nice sort of thing, but with straight investigative detail. One after the other, the points are raised. Everything is tracked down to the ultimate nth degree until you realize that all the evidence is in fact there. That St. Paul's Bay is not where St. Paul came ashore. He did in fact come ashore just over there, according to the theory, and I think it's probably accurate because the evidence is so powerful.
When I used to testify in high-profile cases, I never had this much evidence. This evidence is just overwhelming. In fact, I believe you'd have to force-feed your mind past reason and logic not to accept this site. It's like Luke was leaving us a treasure map for someone to follow. I mean, it's so detailed when other parts we don't even know anything about the other shipwrecks Paul was on. The anchors were there and the right amount at the right depth and before the bay with the beach where the two seas meet and the reef was at the right depth, but the degrees of probability are so overwhelming that these are the anchors from Paul's shipwreck.
Al sou dit nie die vier spesifieke ankers wees nie, dink ek is daar genoegsame bewyse dat hy wel die, wat is nou 'n mooi Afrikaanse woord, verby die strand ontdek het waar die skipbreuk werklik plaasgevind het. Vinnig net nog 'n paar skyfies, en hulle het die eiland deurgegaan tot by Paphos en 'n tovenaar gevind, 'n valse profeet, 'n Jood met die naam van Bar Jesus. Hy was by die goewerneur Sergius Paulus, 'n verstandige man. Die het Barnabas en Saulus laat roep en het versoek om die woord van God te hoor. Toe die goewerneur dan sien wat daar gebeur het, was hy verslae oor die leer van die Here en het geglo. So hier vind ons 'n goewerneur genaamd Sergius Paulus op hierdie eiland Paphos, en hierdie man het tot geloof gekom. Is daar bewyse dat daar ooit so 'n goewerneur was op die eiland? Ek dink is in Cyprus. En natuurlik vind ons dan in 1877 is hierdie steen net buitekant Paphos op die eiland Cyprus ontdek met die volgende inskripsie: Sergius Paulus die goewerneur. Nog 'n bewys dat die Bybel akkuraat is. Gaius, my gasheer en ook van die hele gemeente groet julle. Erastus, die penningmeester van die stad en die broeder Quartus groet julle ook. Dis Romeine 16 vers 23. Bybelkenners meen dat Romeine is geskryf deur Paulus terwyl hy in Korinthe was. Met ander woorde, hierdie Erastus moes dan in Korinthe die penningmeester of die stadstesourier gewees het. En so vind ons dan 'n inskripsie. In 1929 is hierdie inskripsie ontdek net buitekant die amfitheater van Korinthe. Daar's die Latynse inskripsie wat so vertaal: Erastus, die stadstesourier, het hierdie plaveisel op sy eie onkoste gelê. Nog 'n bewys dat hierdie man werklik geleef het wat Paulus vir die gemeente gesê dat hy hulle groet, so nog 'n gelowige. Dan lees ons in Handelinge 18 vers 12, nadat Galio die goewerneur van Gaia geword het. Nou Galio het hulle ook gesê was iemand wat sommer net uitgedink is deur die Bybelskrywers, tot hulle 'n brief ontdek het wat deur die keiser van daardie tyd geskryf is aan Galio, en daarin word na hom verwys ook as die goewerneur van Gaia. Hierdie inskripsie is gevind in Delphi en dit dateer uit die tydperk wat Paulus in Korinthe was en is dus 'n baie sterk bewys van die historiese akkuraatheid van die boek Handelinge. Dr. Clifford Wilson sê die volgende: I know of no finding in archaeology that is properly confirmed which is in opposition to the scriptures. The Bible is the most accurate history textbook the world has ever seen. Dr. Nelson Glueck sê, it may be stated categorically that no archaeological discovery has ever controverted a biblical reference. Scores of archaeological findings have been made which confirm in clear outline or exact detail historical statements in the Bible, and by the same token, proper evaluation of biblical description has often led to amazing discoveries. Die Bybel sê vir ons in Lukas 19:40, ek sluit ook weer af met hierdie vers, Jesus sê, ek sê vir julle, as hulle swyg, sal die klippe uitroep. Ons het nou gekyk na argeologiese bewyse. Die vorige sessie het ons gekyk vanaf die vloed tot by die rigters. Vanaand het ons gekyk in die eerste gedeelte na die koningsgeskiedenis. Met ander woorde, die hele Ou Testament is vir ons geverifieer deur argeologiese bewyse dat dit werklik geskiedkundig akkuraat is. Persone wat geleef het in Jesus se tyd het ons ook na gekyk vanaand, en ook na bewyse wat vir ons staaf dat die boek Handelinge plaasvind. Ek sê weer eens, ek het vir u maar die punt van die ysberg gewys. Daar is talle en talle ander ontdekkings wat ook gemaak is wat hierdie verhale vir ons staaf. En werklik, die klippe roep uit. Volgende sessie, woensdag aand, gaan ons kyk na hierdie vraag: is die manuskripte wat ons het, waaruit ons Bybels vertaal is, die Hebreëse en Griekse manuskripte wat ons vandag het, is dit betroubaar? Kan ons dit glo? Hoe kan ons seker wees dat dit wel behoue gebly het deur al die eeue? Soos ons vir u gesê het, want die Bybel is vir 'n tydperk van 1500 jaar geskryf. Moenie woensdag aand mis nie. Baie baie dankie dat u hier was.